So, learning theories, attitudes to technology, and the impact on teaching. Why this topic? I think Zane just made that clear. But the question, how do we learn, is a fundamental question that has been addressed through the centuries. Also, recent technological advances have made some kind of intersection into that area, and they present many opportunities and challenges in learning. Furthermore, understanding how people learn would dictate how people teach. Having said that, I understand that learning is much, much wider than teaching, which means that teaching is not a prerequisite for learning. People can learn in other ways. You don't need to be taught to learn, but teaching obviously should aim to facilitate learning. Why me? Why I'm doing this topic? Because I think that Jane has made that clear. So yes, I started as a philosopher, but when I realized that not many people were willing to pay me to philosophize, I do something else. The closest to that was teaching. It was part of my degree, BA in philosophy and education. So I started as a secondary teacher of classics. And I must say that back then, technology was quite unappealing, so it wasn't like today. Back then, technology computers were quite unappealing, and for me, it was an interest. It was a professional interest to move on to that area. So although I'm not old, I'm not part of the digital generation either. And from then on, as Jane described, I moved on to staff development and teaching with technology and without. So, the first area we're going to cover now is learning theories that address how people learn. And I will start with educational philosophy, move on to educational psychology, or else called cognitive psychology, developmental psychology, before I move on to the technological advances and the way they are now lately have been feeding into the learning theories. And all that, obviously, is subjected to some social, economical, and political pressures. So I will touch on that, because education does not happen in a vacuum. And before I talk about learning theories, I thought to just state the obvious and put up some reasons why the trial and error approach is not a particularly good one approach to learning. I mean, it's better to learn from our mistakes rather than not, but I wouldn't advise that as a learning kind of approach. We don't have unlimited time, we're not vampires, we're not living forever, so we really need to get going. Errors, consequences can be costly, and the last point is that it's not good for a learner's confidence, and I will come back to that last point later on with some of the latest learning theories, because that's quite important. To put the context, and these are my great-great-grandfathers, Plato and Aristotle. Plato on the left, the guy, Aristotle, his student, his pupil, and that's the university that I studied my first degree named after. If we try to trace learning theories, we'll find that the historical context comes down to rationalism and empiricism. Rationalism, presented mainly by Plato, states that knowledge derives from the mind and the mind alone. So everything happens in the mind. In an ideal state, the mind always knew the truth, and education's kind of purpose is to bring that back, to recall, to remember what the mind knew in the world of ideas. And then Aristotle comes along with empiricism. He challenges his tutor, and that's how knowledge gets created. And he says that no, knowledge doesn't derive from the mind, from what we do. That's how we learn. We experience and we learn from through the senses. Approximately 2,000 years later, and in his famous work, Critique of Pure Reason, what he does is he moves beyond that dualism of the rationalists and the empiricists. And they say, and he says, that experience are shaped and structured by the mind, but the mind alone can also lead to theoretical illusions. So what we need is a convergence. We need to go beyond that dualism and move on. That happened in the 18th century. And I have listed his four main questions, and who am I, what can I know, learn, based on my senses, based on the abilities of my mind, what am I supposed to hope for, and what should I do? Those were, learning was seen as holistically back then. And one of his main four questions was explicitly about learning and how do we learn. So that's just a bit of a background in that area. And now I'm going to move on to modern theories of learning, namely behaviorism, cognitivism, and constructivism. Those are the main theories, and then we will see how those have been intersected by technology in the second part of this talk. So, for behaviorists, it is unknown what happens inside someone's mind. So they're not concerned on what you do, what happens here, they don't know. They just focus on what can be observed. Any kind of changes that can be observed, that's the focus of a behaviorist. So it's the focus is on behavioral change based on responses to stimuli. There are some responses, and we see a change based on that response. What I will do to make that clear is I will play just for a minute a little video highlighting that idea of behaviorism, and then we will see how that applies into teaching. It's a very short video.
Can pigeons read? This one gives every indication, because he's been taught to distinguish between two words and to behave appropriately. He's learned his different response to each sign by being rewarded with food. So the bird isn't acting independently. Its behavior is shaped by controlling its environment. The first task was to isolate an individual piece of behavior and see how that could be changed. Skinner did this by keeping individual pigeons at about 3/4 of their normal weight, so that the birds were always hungry, and food could be used as an automatic reward. The pigeon was studied in a uniform box, one it quickly grew used to. One piece of behavior, pecking a colored disc, was measured on a graph.
I'll stop it here. You get the idea of behaviorism. It's training, really, and it works even with birds. It works with animals, it works with everything. Now, the behavioral teaching approaches have been described as largely didactic. So that approach is an instructivist approach that aims to build stimulus-response association. And there is feedback there, but that feedback is aimed to provide some instructional cues in order for people to practice and reinforce their learning. The memory is not addressed at all, but all the feedback does is trying to reinforce the process with providing those instructional cues. And it's important that motivation here is key. So we need people to be motivated in order to learn. And this approach has been criticized heavily because it sees learning as a mechanical process. However, there is still something in there because it's not just a neurological response, but it's also motivational. Moving on to cognitivism. Cognitivism is a branch of psychology called developmental or cognitive psychology that is concerned with the different stages that people are and they are ready to learn. So as a child develops, they go through various stages in their development and they are ready to be exposed to different theories and learn different things. So cognitivists take into account one's prior knowledge and they see learning like building blocks. So learning is built based on what you know already. And also, obviously, they see learning as symbolic mental constructs, which means that something needs to happen for learning and knowledge to get internalized. And the approaches based on this theory, the teaching approaches, focus on more complex cognitive processes and on problem solving as well. But they are also concerned with language and concept formation. And moving on from behaviorism to cognitivism, there is a shift from focusing on manipulating the materials to be learned to really interacting with those. Constructivism is the third theory, and constructivism is considered by many a branch of cognitivism. Most westernized societies have adopted this approach because it sees learners as active seekers of their knowledge and they are attempting to create meaning on their own. So whereas in cognitivism there is an objective reality out there and what we're trying to do is help people meet that reality. With constructivism, we take them and we kind of try to make them create their own meaning, actively constructive learning. So here, the focus shifts from knowledge as a product to knowing as a process. It's more about the process of knowing. And teachers here become facilitators of the learning process. So it's not so much now about content transfer, being the expert giving you the content, but it's more about facilitating the learning process. And there are some good reasons why constructivism has become a really powerful theory. We'll see if there are any limitations in a minute. This highlights the main elements of constructivism, which is social. Learning is a social process. It is also experiential, so you learn by doing. It is contextual and aims to learn in real-world scenarios, real-world contexts. So some of the constructivist teaching approaches include those. So the focus is no longer the content, but a range of sources is utilized so that the meaning is co-constructed with the learner. And tasks are situated in real-world scenarios as well. So we're talking about contextual, situated, authentic learning. And here, as well, problem solving and collaborative learning are commonly used approaches. Now, is there any that sounds good? It sounds great. And as I said, it has become the dominant theory in the West. Are there any limitations to that? This is a picture from Weapons of Math Destruction. So the board says constructivism, process-oriented, no defined result, group work, low on skills. I don't agree on that, but high on equality. And the person says, our goal is socialization, not education. Can anyone think of a better delivery mechanism than constructivism? What that means is that constructivism might not, despite its many advantages, is not a panacea. It may not work with everyone. And also, if you take it to the extreme, then education becomes indoctrination. So what are we left with? We have seen all those three approaches. We have discussed some of the benefits and limitations. What can we do as teachers, those of us who are in education? That's a good question. I think what we need is a fusion of the learning theories. And we need to go beyond, move beyond of which one is the better. I have heard, I have seen in conferences, I have heard people arguing that constructivism and social constructivism is the best approach. However, it's not a panacea, as you say. And it has been argued already in the literature that different theories can be used in different ways. So if we want to teach facts, what? We can use some behaviorist strategies. In order to teach processes and principles, so the how, we can use cognitive strategies. And constructivist strategies come later when the learners have matured enough, when they are quite advanced, to be able to benefit from it. And it can be used for higher level thinking and so on. Here, I have put a slide from Bloom's taxonomy. And what that shows is it's a pyramid of some areas, knowing, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. And again, behaviors could be used for those two in the bottom of the pyramid to remember and understand. Cognitivism could be used when we're moving along, moving up, to apply, and constructivism could be used further up. One point I would like to make here is that although this pyramid implies a hierarchy, it's not always the higher the better. That is not the case. And what happens is, in order to go up there, you need all those other elements. And to give you a practical example of what I mean by that is that we wouldn't take a first year student and expose him to constructivist principles and expect him to create, give him some kind of, allocate him into some group work and expect him to create something. There is scaffolding that needs to take place, so people need to go through all those steps. And it's not so much the higher the better, it's more about what is appropriate for that level of learner and so on. Moving on to attitudes to technology, I have four statements there, and I will ask in a bit to vote for one of them. It's not a right or wrong question here. What we are doing here is we're looking at some attitudes, some assumptions everyone makes about technology and its role in learning generally as well. And it stands that technology is neutral, and that people have autonomy and control over it. So I'm the user, I use technology, it's neutral, it's up to me how it's used, and I don't give any agency to technology itself. Then, there are those who think that technology is not neutral, and that can be either positive or negative, depending on the viewpoint. So it could be positive that, yes, I know it's not neutral, I know it's kind of, I know there is some technological determinism, but I think it can be used to expand access to learning and increase the quality of learning experience. Or if I see technological determinism as negative, I will say that it's not neutral and it has a political role into sustaining advanced populations, and that e-learning is not the best approach in that case. Finally, statement 4 focuses more on the social structures. So education, social structures, and technology are all kind of influencing each other. As I said, this is not a right or wrong question, but can I see hands, please, who thinks that technology is neutral and we have autonomy and control over it? Is there any? No? Understand? I move on to the second statement. Technology is not neutral. It can be used to expand access to learning and increase the quality of the learning experience. Yes, I can see many hands. That's good. Who thinks that technology is not neutral and that's a bad thing, that it has a political role in sustaining advantaged populations? Yes, a couple of people. Okay, that's interesting. And finally, who thinks that the use of technology is heavily influenced by social structures? That's interesting. So yes, the most popular are number 2 and number 4, from what I have seen. And that's very interesting. What I have done here is I have mapped those attitudes to technology, and we have neutral technological determinism and social determinism as well. Usually those who think that it's neutral, they see it as a positive thing. It's very interesting that not even one person here thought of that. It's interesting that if you think it's neutral, then it cannot be a bad thing, because it's up to you what you do with it. So you have control over it, you use it. If you don't like how you use it differently. So that's a largely positive view. It's good that no one voted for it, because this view has been criticized as being naive. It is a naive view. I used to have that view myself. And I would say, I would admit, that across the years in my cyclical process, I have moved along all those kind of ideas, attitudes, stances, if you like. Moving on to the center, I have put technologies value ladder, technological determinism. They are the same thing, but usually if you hear the expression technological determinism, it often refers to it being a negative thing. Not necessarily, but most often. For its value ladder is kind of the same thing, technological determinism, but a little bit more positive. And there are people that think that technological determinism is a good thing, because what it does, and we'll see that later on, that's an important point, it gives us measurable and systems that allow tracking, so we can track people's learning, we can see what's happening. And that's a good thing, we'll see why in a minute. And they see also technology as a factor for change and progress. Those who see it as a negative thing, they say that e-learning technologies can disseminate incoherent trivialities. That's the traditional Marxist view, and that view has been adopted by many, many philosophers of the last century, Habermas, Marcuse, Heidegger, Lyotard. All those adopted a very critical, deterministic view of technology. They were pre-internet, but still, that was a view about technology. Technology in education, or technology in general. Now, what we see more lately is the rise of this idea of social determinism, that education and technology are both value laden, and the power relationships in teaching and learning are central. What that means is that technology, us, and social structures are always in mutual shaping. We have some control over it, but no, we don't have 100% control of even the way that we're using technology. Sometimes we're used by it. That's the kind of idea of determinist here, but here it's more the emphasis on the social structure and the social influence into the technological use. And moving on, now I'm going to talk about how the new technologies have influenced traditional pedagogies as we explained, as we described them so far. And these days, with the internet, and in particular with the Web 2.0 tools, people can go online, people can participate in learning networks in a university, but they can extend and create their own personal learning networks as well. And that's quite interesting. And I have put here, in three circles, how technology, the kind of three different phases of technology, if you like. Initially, we had computer-based learning that primarily utilized behaviorist and cognitivist approaches into learning. So you had the CD-ROMs in the old days, that you were interacting with the materials and you were training yourself to learn something. But then with the internet and those web 2.0 tools, we moved on to networked learning. And that's quite important because that challenged traditional pedagogies quite a lot. And because it offers the opportunity to create your own networks for learning. So what is network learning, which has seen, which has become quite popular and has been researched over the last 10, 20 years? It makes use of ICT in order to promote connections between learners, between learners and resources, learners and tutors, and so on. And it is quite interesting because network learning takes the theory of communities of practice further, and it acknowledges the fact that if you are part of a network, a learning network, not only you don't have to be always in the center of that network. They recognize that there is value in strong and weak ties as well in those learning networks. So you can be in the periphery, or in some networks you can be in the center, in others you can be in the periphery, and there is value in that too. And obviously network learning has utilized the internet and various communication and collaboration tools for interactions with people and with the learning resources. That's fine so far, but what happened next is quite interesting and quite controversial still, as seen by many people. From network learning, we moved on to connectivist learning. And that, as I said, is quite, quite controversial. And a lot of people are very unconvinced still. Some people call it a learning theory, others do not accept it to be a learning theory, but something else. And it has about 10 years of existence. It was conceived in 2004 or 5 by Stephen Domes and George Zimmans in Canada. But it became more popular after 2008, and in particular 2011, with the rise of the MOOC, the Massive Open Online Courses. I will get to that back. What connectivist theorists think is that learning, they go beyond learning being internal, external, in the mind, acquired by experience, and all that. They make a huge claim, saying that learning can reside outside us. That's quite an interesting thought. Learning can also reside outside us. Is that true? They say that it can reside in networks, in databases, and so on. I think that's more information, data, but not learning, if learning is defined as actionable knowledge by people. Connectivism incorporates chaos, network, complexity, and self-organization theories, according to its founders, who make a claim that the connections that enable us to learn are more important than our current state of knowing. Another phrase they have used is that the pipe is more important than the content within the pipe. What if it's a sewage pipe? So that's a very challenging and interesting theory. And learning approaches utilized by connectivist learners are based on the fact that learning resides outside us, and that there is chaos and network theory and self-organization theory and so on, is that massive numbers of people can learn together with little support from tutors. And that's fine for non-formal education, but I think it could be damaging for formal education. Learners, again, decide what they want to learn there. They interact with peers, with other learners, for support. They reflect on their own learning, using blogs and stuff like that. And they put their own goals of what they want to learn. And connectivism lends itself quite well to adult learning and continual professional development because of that, exactly because of that, because you need to take control. And this is a picture that shows learning in a connected MOOC. So learners go and watch videos online, they tweet, those birds are Twitter, they reflect, writing some blog posts, they read some stuff, they comment, and so on. And that's quite, you know, it can happen in a kind of a random way regarding the connections, because the tutor is just a node in the network, is not central in the learning process. And those are some MOOC platforms, because connectivism has found application onto MOOCs, in particular the connected MOOCs. Although those platforms, some of them are kind of following more the extended MOOC, which goes back to behaviorism, but that's another story. So these are some example nodes in a network based on Twitter use in a MOOC. So what we see there is a few hundred or a thousand people creating their own personal networks, informal networks, using Twitter or other tools, Twitter in this occasion. And we can see how the interactions take place. I'll get back to that in a second. What are the limitations of network and connectivist learning? are there any? The first one is very obvious. I will just read it and not comment on that. The crowd can be a source of wisdom, but can equally be a source of stupidity. But I will expand a little bit on the second point. The learning networks are often imaginary, argued by folks. Going back to this, what this shows is interactions. People are interacting. If someone does content analysis on those interactions, in many of those cases, they will probably find that the network interactions are not focused on those participants learning, but it could be on anything. It could be exchange of information at best, or it could be something else, tweeting and retweeting someone else's tweet and replying, yes, that's interesting. All that, so it doesn't necessarily mean that, that this network is a learning network. It is a network of interaction, but network theory was originally conceived in order to kind of predict some health risks and stuff like that. So to give you an example, when I come back from Greece, door to door, I have to travel for 12 hours. And those 12 hours I spent on a bus, on a plane, and on a train. On my way back from Christmas, I picked up, so I had to kind of, I interact with many people. But on my way back from Christmas, I picked up some germs, but I didn't learn anything from that person who gave me those germs. So I was part of that network, but all I did was someone's germs. So network theory, can it always explain network learning? I'm not arguing that network learning doesn't happen. It can happen, but it's not the default position of a network. This is my point. And as I'm getting towards the end, because I have mentioned quite a lot of stuff about technological determinism, about different positions, I would like to play my own socially constructed artifact about MOOCs. It's only 3 minutes long, and then I have just a slide to kind of sum it all up. What we will see here is two opposing views. They're both technologically determinist views, one positive by Dr. Gregarious, and one negative by Dr. Precarious. And the names have been chosen for a reason. This is a 3 minute long, and also demonstrates how artifacts can be kind of socially constructed, because I did it on my own, but I did it based on my reflection and interaction with many people when I was taking a MOOC, a massive open online course in e-learning and digital cultures in particular. And that will also take me to the last slide.
Hello, we have the pleasure to be joined by Dr. Gregarious and Dr. Precarious today in order to continue the conversation on MOOCs and their impact in higher ed. So, Dr. Gregarious, tell us about MOOCs and how you think they will revolutionize HE.
Hello, Mrs. Brown. Indeed, MOOCs are going to change higher education for good. The impact is going to be huge, not only for online, but also for on-campus education. I think it was time for higher education to get modernized and digital.
What do you think, Dr. Precarious?
I am not sure about the MOOC effect yet. The history of technology in education is full of unfulfilled promises. I do not see why it is going to be any different this time.
This time we are ready for it, and students are ready for it too. Traditional higher education has just become too expensive and outdated. We need to educate the citizens of the future differently.
Opening access to higher education learning to millions of people is a fantastic idea. Does this raise any issues around quality, Dr. Gregarious?
There are challenges, but they will be addressed in two ways. One, making use of the latest technological advances in adaptive learning, and two, making use of peer-to-peer support. Subgroups and subcommunities will emerge among participants.
Can you elaborate on that, Dr. Gregarious?
Well, MOOCs are gathering enormous data about participants' preferences, where they click, what resources they use and what paths they follow. All the data will get processed, and we will create smart MOOCs in the near future that provide tailored lessons according to individual learning styles and preferences. Furthermore, MOOCs are harnessing the power of online communities of practice to promote social learning, where people learn from their peers.
Interesting, but how is this going to work around assessment and feedback?
It could work with quizzes that provide automated grading and feedback, or with peer assessment of any other type of coursework, based on clearly defined criteria.
In the latter case, grading could be very inconsistent. Also, what about issues regarding plagiarism?
Well, at the moment this is not an issue, as MOOCs do not carry academic credit as yet.
These fundamental issues might be unresolvable, Dr. Gregarious.
Do not be so sure about that, Dr. Precarious. If this does not work, then students could evidence their learning online and come to a campus for their assessment and certification.
Transforming campuses from learning communities to assessment centers. Is that your vision for higher education, Dr. Gregarious?
No, it is not. But, on the other hand, don't you think that higher education needs to be reformed?
Probably, but a reform needs to be planned in advance, rather than by throwing ourselves to an ocean and use hope and wishful thinking as a lifeboat.
Education needs to move on, and technology will be its vehicle.
Technology also created the atomic bomb.
Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for your contribution to the conversation.
And you will be pleased to know that this is my final slide. So, what are the current and future technological developments? Are we in search of the algorithm of learning? I don't think that such a thing exists. Learning analytics, big data, and machine learning. Big data are data that all those learners, the thousands, the millions of learners, the biggest MOOC platform, Coursera, has 15 million of learners enrolled. What they are doing, as Dr. Gregarious mentioned, is they're gathering enormous data about learners' preferences, paths, what they do. And this is what called big data. Learning analytics, an area that has emerged in the last 3 or 5 years, still new, still in its infancy, is the area that is trying to make sense and process that data for learning. And we can see that this is perhaps a very technologically determinist view, but it's happening. The other thing is that software for automated marking of essays has already been developed. It's not perfect yet, it's not that good, and it's unreliable. People are against of it being used for summative purposes at least. But developments in that area take place as we speak. And those are advances in machine learning, which is moving on from big data and intelligent analytics, trying to project what the outcome will be. To give you an example, for instance, Turnitin, which is a company that stores essays from all universities around the world electronically. They have partnered with a company that is trying to do exactly that. That company claims, I watched a webinar last year, and the person, the researcher talking, claimed that if you have the same kind of essay title year on year, which I think is bad practice, but anyway, if you have it year on year, the same topic, and if you feed the system with a few hundred or up to 1,000 graded essays, humanly graded essays, the system itself will learn, machine learning, how to grade the next 1,000 essays that will come through. This is still under development, And, you know, this is where we are. And on that point, I think in my references, time for questions.
So, is that based on the algorithm of learning then for Turnitin, how computers learn independent AI from being fed some variables? Is that what you're talking about?
Yes. The algorithm of learning is something that I have made up. You know, I don't know if it's there. It's just I'm saying, you know, are we looking for the algorithm of learning? Are we looking to find to turn the stone into gold? That's my point really there. The others, machine learning, yes, it's very close to artificial intelligence, and it is based on learning analytics and big data. So we first gather the big data, then we try to make sense of them and process them with learning analytics. And then with machine learning, we try to make projections for the future. So,
the different learning approaches and different learning theories that you have mentioned, especially constructivism and behaviorism, and their application in different disciplines, and the use of technology in the application in different academic disciplines. How would you go about that?
That's an excellent question, because I think that you're right. I think that what happens mostly in social sciences is that they emphasize the constructivist approaches. Science, perhaps cognitive isn't defined for it. And that's my response to that. So it's, I would say, generally, and I try to make that point, that you have, it's very good, we need to know, we need to be familiar, those of us in education, we need to be familiar with learning theories, because they will inform our teaching approaches, and with attitudes to technology too. But the thing is that we don't have to be limited by them. We don't have, they are not religions. And that's why also, given the background context and everything, so that we get an idea of how they have evolved, and perhaps we're now under current new kind of evolution. I'm a bit skeptical about connectivism, at least. I'm fine with network learning, but I'm a bit skeptical with connected learning, like many people are. And, you know, things may change. 20 years ago, what I'm saying now may be irrelevant, maybe sooner than that. I don't know. But this is kind of the idea. And it's a great question, because different disciplines perhaps have, and different levels of learning can utilize different techniques. And I don't think that one should be limited to one technique. Even what I said, that science is cognitivism is fine, yes, they can use other kind of approaches too. What is your view on that?
My view?
Yes.
Well, there are academic disciplines that don't really lend themselves to certain teaching approaches, yeah. And this applies also to assessment and to all the surrounding things that are in those processes. For example, in computer science, and when you want to, or in disciplines where you want to measure the performance of the student in such a way that there's just a yes or no question, how are you going to use an approach that is values the critical approach to the artifact that you produce as a student? How you criticize your own, or how you ask why you are writing a script, and why is it working or not, and how you make a critical decision on that.
Very good point, and that's why we need different teaching approaches based on those different theories and the fusion of all. Any other questions?
So just in response to that, I wonder what approach the Facebook took in terms of the reasons why they were creating code. So, you know, they're an exponent of code used for a kind of very social purpose, aren't they? So it wasn't just a kind of yes, no, there was a kind of why would you be doing that? And I'm interested in what Timos was saying about not accepting or rejecting either of the learning theories, and also interested in what you were saying with regards to the subject content dictating the blend of learning paradigms that you might use, and also you mentioned level four students that you might not have an emphasis on social constructivist approach to learning, but I wondered whether you felt in all circumstances it would always have some kind of blend of all of the learning paradigms rather than sort of specifically one, or do you think there's ever going to be a situation where it would just be one approach?
I think I made the point of a fusion of learning theories, so yeah. That's my point. A fusion is needed and it's good practice. It's good to know, but we don't have to go back to Descartes and argue. Descartes spent half of his life writing essays of how experience is not to be trusted. Only the mind, we can trust only our mind, because experience can deceive us. Or the other way, the empiricists were kind of hardcore in thinking that only experience is valid, that's all I have. The mind can cause theoretical illusions. I don't want to go into that. I propose a fusion of learning approaches, and it's interesting that learning theories and teaching approaches and their appropriate use, that word appropriate is quite interesting. So there is all that is the background to that, if that makes sense. Osama?
My question is, for Solent, with a social inclusive agenda, where there could be a body of learners within the university, quite a significant amount, who probably don't have the social construct of fully engaging with a constructivism type of an approach. So if there's a spectrum between behavioralism and constructivism, where one is quite deductive and another is totally, it's up to you how you learn and you get on with your knowledge and I'm just facilitating. If I really have to decide where we should lie, given our student body, what's your suggestion? Why should we?
That's an excellent question. And it's very interesting because we're a university that we also value diversity and all that. And I believe, as you said, that when the students come here, not everyone has the confidence and the social capital to benefit from largely constructivist approaches. And all the conferences I'm going to, they say constructivism, social constructivism. If I come here, if I'm international, and in my first month here, you kind of put me in a group, give me a collaborative line to work with people I don't very well know, and with tasks that I don't really understand or know much about, I may struggle a bit. So it's a very interesting question, and I don't want to generalize on that, but what I would like to say is that having that question in our minds and trying to look to whom we are talking to and trying to accommodate their needs is the main thing, and a variety of approaches would apply. But yes, there would be, it's not a panacea. Constructivism is not a panacea. It's not going to work in all situations, all learning scenarios. And a lot of people in their first year here, international and not, may be kind of a little bit scared of such approaches at first. So there is nothing wrong of kind of working with content with them and building their confidence up and utilize those approaches a bit later. So, and always, although there is science behind it, teaching is really reflective practice, isn't it? So what I do is, I do it, then I reflect. I reflect in action, I have to reflect as I do it. If I see you sleeping, maybe I do something wrong, maybe I should jump. Maybe I should play in a movie or something, I don't know. But it's reflective. We have the science of it, but we need to be reflective. Reflect in action, reflect for action, and reflect afterwards as well, and adapt our approaches.
Tim, so your last point about machine learning, do you think there's a point in the future where humans will be able to learn from the machine learning, if that makes sense?
So if you can explain that a little bit, I'll try.
So computers, artificial intelligence, computers learning from themselves, at some stage computers are going to learn exponentially, much, much quicker than humans. And indeed, they'll be learning things on our behalf, learning things that we didn't expect to want to learn as humans. What do you think the impact's going to be on learning for humans in the future?
That's a great question, and I think some people, I didn't put it there because it goes into science fiction a bit. I don't know if you have heard of transhumanism. Some people are very positive that's technological determinism to the extreme. That is like having chips implanted under your skin and stuff like that. It's the verge of the human and the machine. I try to be more human rather than a robot, but that's just me. I don't know how else, unless you're not talking about that, unless you're not talking about the merge, the fusion of the human and the robot, if you are talking about learning from the machine, the difficulty is, and we have it now, take big data and learning analytics, for instance. Yes, we have a huge amount of information and data out there, but we are struggling to make sense of them. So I think that in as much as we remain human, there will be always that struggle. No matter how smart machine learning becomes, no matter how much artificial intelligence kind of excels in the future, we will have the same limitations unless we become cyborgs or transhumans. And there are some people who think that's the future of humanity and they look forward to it. I'm not. Yes, please.
As part of your review of constructivism, you said that one of the critiques of it is education becomes indoctrination. Could you unpack that a little for me?
Yes, if I bring that up again, am I going the wrong way? Yeah. So, I think this is a very nice picture. It says, our goal is socialization, not education. Can you now think of a better delivery mechanism and construct this? Then, where I said that education becomes indoctrination. Cognitivism, even behaviorism with its many limitations, they see reality as objective and they try to make people kind of meet that reality, if you like, learn that objective reality. With constructivism, what you get is, you get that the focus is on social, and constructivism, although it emerged as a branch of cognitivism, it doesn't necessarily see everything as being objective. It claims that your reality is also subjective. And that reality, if it is subjective, and if our focus is on socialization, social learning, which is quite important, I don't want to undermine that. It's very important. People come to university, they want to get social, and learning is a social process. But if the focus is just that, then education can become indoctrination, and kind of we coerce, in other words, we coerce the students to work in groups in certain ways in order to be ready to find a job in a certain context afterwards. So that's what I meant by indoctrination. That we lose a little bit, we lose the objective, we lose the science, we lose what's out there, and we just are more concerned on how we do things. We are more concerned with the social and the cultural. Yes, please.
With the advancements of technology, there's been a shift in the way students and people learn. Do we not feel that maybe technology is dumbing down the intellect of how to do critical thinking, make analysis, and it is stripping back the socialization process of traditional learning as such? How do you feel that this might take place in the future with technology?
I think that what you just said sounds like you have adopted the determinist view of technology, negative, which is fine to hear. And what my point was that it's good to be aware of those positions, because I have said similar stuff in the past, but I have said also the opposite in different phases of my career. And I recognize that there is not a single truth. And what my point there is that, yes, this has been stated, the professionalization, some of the theorists are focusing on the deprofessionalization of the academy based on the distance education. Others, though, they see it as a move forward and they focus on the tools for that aid reflection, blogs and stuff like that. So you will find that those opposing views, they are all out there. And to me, you know, they have a point, both of them. I'm not contradicting myself. I'm just saying that everything is out there already. It has been said already, and there have been good claims for both views. And depending on how it's implemented, I think that e-learning can do both. I think that technology can enhance learning, but also if it's not done properly, it can kind of deliver those inconsistent trivialities and sacrifice reflexivity and depth. So I think everything goes not at the same time.
You touched on, well, the learning happens outside of us, and if we decide to define us, there is actually outside of the university. You touched on MOOCs. There's the mass connectivism of things like Mumsnet, for instance. Lots of people on there learning small amounts of knowledge at a time. And there's private business now moving into the university sector.
Yeah.
So with those factors and the technology seemingly producing some sort of race to the bottom, I'm not sure where the bottom is, but how do you think all of those external factors are going to affect the university as a seat of learning when there's all these other seats of learning out there? Some call it the education black market, but...
Yeah, that's an interesting point. I think it's quite interesting. I think there are a couple of things happening there. And one thing is that we have to distinguish between formal and non-formal learning, and MOOCs and the connectivism and all that, they kind of address more the CPD market. So you need a little bit of specialization here and there, and you do a MOOC, you get a nice little time. However, as you said, Roger, now the plans of the government are to make it much, much easier for an organization to award degrees and degree powers. So I think that the game will change. And with technology, obviously, a lot of institutions will offer more online courses, but that's, as we have seen here, it's not a very easy thing to do in terms of offering a kind of substantive portfolio of online courses and also recruiting on those courses. So no one really knows what is going to happen. We are through a process of change, and things will be very different, I think, in the next 5 or 10 years. And on that, is it time to sum
up? There is so much interest. I almost hesitate to intercept, and I think it's probably possible for colleagues to carry on these conversations. And the fact that these conversations are taking place and there's so much interest in the lecture is testimony to how much Timos has stimulated thinking this evening. And I'm very proud, actually, that this university is hosting a lecture of this kind and that we have so much engagement with how our learners learn and with exploring how technology has prompted us to think differently about how our learners learn. I think it's a very inspiring moment. So can I say thank you on our behalf to Timos this evening? He has given us a lecture which in many ways epitomises his very own enthusiastic and committed view. I did have a little look, actually, on Twitter. I very rarely do this. I only recently discovered what Bluebird was. But I did look on Twitter, and I did see that on the 8th of January, you actually tweeted, "We are so lucky to do this job." And I think your lecture was a fantastic testimony to that enthusiasm. So on behalf of the university, can I give you a little gift to thank you, Timos, for your lecture this evening.
Thank you very much.